I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Open your mind. Exercise your imagination. This week, Stanton Forbes, labyrinth of tropical intrigue. But I wouldn't want to die there. Starring Leonel Frisoff. Brock Peters. And Marge Redmond. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour.
The Mutual Broadcasting System presents The Zero Hour. Sponsored in part by Chevrolet Trucks, Cold Power, and Sign Off. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
There's a saying about too many cooks. The same could apply to a jigsaw puzzle. Too many hands spoil the fun. The puzzle is this. Who killed Annabelle Lee? The St. Martin police want to know. So does the press. The lady's husband thinks he knows. People on the island are wondering about their neighbors, their friends. Reporters from the United States have come asking the same questions, testing the same pieces. Of all those, only Sylvia Bennett is an expert. And an expert at puzzles has from the start the final picture in mind. She has only to assemble the pieces. Or does she? But I wouldn't want to die there, continues after this word.
Scald yourself to death with the coffee. All right, I should be separated from my soul by now. This letter, Todd, you're so long-winded. Don't you realize you have something missing? I should be indebted to you for this reprieve. Is that it? Well, I'm not. But I'll read on because I must. Be merciful, please. Be quick about it. The fourth morning.
A yowl like that of an animal awakened me.
What on earth? What's that? My specs, where are my glasses?
Cat, wait for me! Let me by!
Eloise, has someone been murdered?
Let me by! Cat, wait! Eloise, what happened?
The gendarmes have taken Madame Bousquet's son to the gendarmerie in Marigot.
But why?
Was that the boy screaming?
I'm not certain, but I believe it has something to do with Mistress Lee's death.
How could that be?
Here comes Alphonse. Maybe he knows.
Mr. Cat, the gendarmes take away Guy Bousquet. They put the handcuffs on him and everything. He might have put up a great fight. Did you hear?
How could we miss it?
But why, Alphonse? Why did they arrest Guy Bousquet?
For spying on Mistress Lee.
Spying?
So there really was a peeping Tom.
How did they find that out?
Someone told them. I do not know who told them, but someone.
Someone told them? That's odd. I still don't believe it.
Believe what? That horrible noise?
Sylvia, they've arrested Guy Bousquet.
I'd go get coffee, Monsieur Ted. Oh, someone better go get the beans. They're barricaded up in their room.
Hell, I was hoping Tolliver did it. I'd love to see that fat cat do time.
Who says he didn't?
But why have they arrested the boy?
It looks like a sex crime. He had the glasses on her.
Max, you don't know that for sure.
It is true, Mr. Cat. I didn't tell the gendarmes, but I see him too. Lots of people know.
There, you see?
Oh, let's get some coffee. I can't think straight. I still don't buy it. Thank you, Eloise.
What's to buy? He's male, isn't he?
But they're so sure she was killed in a boat. I've never seen Guy Bousquet go anywhere near the water. He never leaves that porch. I suppose it's possible.
Well, of course it's possible. It makes sense. Somebody with scrambled eggs for brains?
We don't know that he's mental. Slow, I know, but mentally disturbed.
Will there be a trial?
Aren't you two being a little quick to judge?
Hey, I need a car and fast. Gerard said they'll be taking the kid to Marigot. I hear there's a reporter from Day Magazine on the island. I gotta scoop that guy.
Well, Rose Phillips has a car she rents.
Thanks.
My, my, the intrepid reporter.
Well, at least now we can get back to normal. Tolliver will get the hell out, and the news hands will go home where they belong. And people will forget. You know they do, Cat. They always forget.
Yes. Yes, I suppose you're right. And I certainly won't miss the American press, such vultures.
How would you like an island celebration this evening, Mrs. Bennett? Cat, you think we can swing it? We'll open up the terrace for a barbecue on the beach.
Well, it might be slightly premature, don't you think? Wouldn't Friday be better? We'd draw a bigger crowd. Maybe Gerard could put an ad in his paper.
Now you're using the old head. Here's the real brains of this outfit, Mrs. Bennett. I'll take a quick inventory and see what we need. Smile, lady. I'm a very nice fellow when you get to know me. You'll see.
He's right, you know. Max is really a great guy once you get to know him.
I'm sure he is. Where are you off to?
Well, somebody should tell Bousquet about his son. I think I'd better go out to his place.
I won't be around for lunch. I'm going off on another shopping spree. But when I get back, may I invite you to have dinner with me? I want to show you I can behave like a lady.
Would you like to eat somewhere else? We don't have to stay here.
Well, what do you recommend?
I'm rather partial to the mini club in Marigot.
The mini club it is, then.
If you'll drive, I'm even less reliable at the wheel after dark.
Maybe you'll keep me on as chauffeur. I work very cheaply.
Any time. You could even take it up as a profession. If you can drive some of our roads, you can drive anywhere. Adieu.
Adieu.
Cat, I can't find Alphonse, so I'll have to do the marketing myself. I just spoke to Gerard. The ad's all set.
I'm going out myself for a while. But I guess I can hang around.
Oh, go on. Eloise can hold the fort.
I won't be long. I was frantic trying to find that man. With my eyesight and driving about, it took me well over an hour to locate Michel Bousquet. I went first to his house, just outside town, but he wasn't there. I didn't know where to look. It was just a lucky break that I ran into Leon DeLong, who was clearing brush nearby. He told me Michel Bousquet had gone to Point Blanche that morning. I finally tracked him down in the little fisherman's bar tucked beneath the pier. Apparently, he was unaware of what had gone on in the morning. Though my only clue to this was the pained expression that crept across his weather-beaten face when I told him his son might be charged with murder. He went off, poor man, to see if there was anything he could do. Suggestion of black unrest had made my ears burn. Why hadn't the famous Annabelle Lee simply drowned? It would have saved us all a lot of grief. Murder is such an ugly word, frightening. And suddenly, with the investigation going on, everyone was tense, everyone a suspect. I waited for you, Sylvia, at the bar, drinking and no big thing, trying to relax, but it was useless. I wasn't even the least bit hungry. Alphonse reported for work while I was sitting there. He had news, but then Alphonse always had news.
Mr. Card, I find out who told the gendarmes about Guy Bousquet. It was Rose Phillips. She told.
Rose Phillips. Why would she? Didn't you tell her Clément and Martin are not suspected?
I tell her, yes. She tell anyway. My uncle Martin, he's in the hospital.
What happened to Martin? Rose Phillips.
Not Rose Phillips. Maria Lisa. She got him with a knife. The gendarmes, they do not know this because my Uncle Martin tells the hospital he has an accident in his boat.
Maria Lisa with a knife. But they love each other. Why in heaven's name would she...
Lisa. Maria Lisa is a very jealous woman, Mr. Card.
Not of Rose Phillips and your Uncle Martin?
Long time ago. I think Maria Lisa is very nervous.
Yes, we all are, but...
Sorry, I'm late. I bought a new dress.
I bring you fresh drinks.
I'm fishing for a compliment.
You look smashing. I've never seen you wear your hair up that way. You've been hiding your beautiful neck all the time.
Thank you, kind sir. I brought the papers. 2 days old, of course. They're full of Annabelle Lee and Saint Martin.
Sylvia, I don't want to even think about Annabelle Lee this evening.
Thank you, Alphonse.
Alphonse, are they Bousquet's back?
Only madame et monsieur. But all is quiet now.
So they're holding Guy.
Here now, none of that. It's your house rule. You just made it. No Annabelle Lee.
Let's get out of here.
Wait, let me finish my drink.
I'll tell Max we're leaving.
Get another night off from school?
I'll just let him know. We do as we please, within reason.
Oh, Cat, I was only teasing. Is the party on for Friday?
I guess so. I didn't see Max all afternoon. He was whistling in the kitchen, though, just before we left.
It should be all right by then, don't you think? Any sooner when it would be like a square dance before a hangout.
Sometimes Max doesn't think things out. Take your next left there. Slow down. Hey, wait. What's going on?
Let's follow. Follow? It's that Bolin.
Then something's up. We're in, though.
What's out this way other than...
Other than Benevenue? Nothing. Whatever's going on, it's going on there. Outside of Marigot, its two-lane paved highway with very few curves, the money man had thought of everything, even straightening the access road. You piloted my little European car, Sylvia, like you'd raced them all your life. But even so, with the small engine, we lagged far behind the others. Even Bolin, who came very close to driving into the sea twice, was merely two tiny red taillights in the distance. When we got to the gate by the dirt construction road, it seemed the whole peninsula was lit up by the reflections of the glass of the whirling red beacons. There was a good deal of running around, remember? The entire police force was there. We were stopped at the gate.
Cab, thank God you're here. They won't let me in. Use some of your influence on these clowns, will you?
Mr. Boland, you'll never learn.
Now, what's that supposed to mean?
Mr. Cadwallader, what are you doing here?
Inspector Leclerc. Mrs. Bennett and I were about to have dinner in Marigot when we kind of got caught up in the traffic. What happened here?
Perhaps you had better come with me.
Hey, what about me?
Just you, Monsieur Cadwallader. Not the lady, I think.
Now, look here.
I'll wait in the car.
Just Monsieur Cadwallader.
I demand you let me pass. I'm a member of the American press.
But you are not on an American island.
You better wait here, Bolin, or you'll end up in jail yourself. The gendarmes take a dim view of interference.
Please, Monsieur Cadwallader. Come now. I am afraid we have a new development. It's somewhat unpleasant one.
Is Guy Bousquet here? Did he tell you to come here?
You are very curious tonight, Monsieur Cadwallader. What you will see might make you wish you were not so curious.
Captain Dubois, Dr. Fortier. What?
Who? Perhaps you cannot recognize him with his face in such a condition. His glasses were smashed to pieces. He is quite dead.
How could anyone do such a thing? He was such a gentle man. Poor Gerard.
Forget your face when you came back to the car. It must have been an ordeal. Gerard's dead, is all you said. You looked awful. All the color was gone from your face. But your voice, I heard anger. The fifth day, word of Gerard's murder,
the second within 5 days, spread havoc rapidly throughout our part of the island. A local had been slain, and the citizens reacted, primarily in fear. My perpetual morning cup of coffee was brought to me by Eloise. Thank you, Eloise. What is it? You look worried.
The gendarmes have called a meeting. They want everyone in Grand Case
everyone except the children to come at 3 o'clock this afternoon. They will open the schoolhouse for the meeting so that all can get in.
I see. All right, thank you.
Monsieur Cad, Alphonse say that Gerard Bonaventure has been killed. Is that true, Monsieur Cad?
Yes, I'm afraid it is. Is there something else? Do you want to tell me something?
Yes, was just here a night ago. I just don't know, Monsieur Cad. He asked me a lot of questions.
He did. Well, that wasn't unusual. Gerard asked everybody a lot of questions. That was his job.
But the questions he asked me, they are about you, Monsieur Cad, and this house and everybody in it.
Did he now? About me? What did he want to know about me?
What you and Monsieur Max do in America, where you live, things like that. I say, Gerard, why do you want to know these things? And he say, I'm just curious, Eloise. We don't know very much about many of the aliens on the island. That's what he call you, aliens. And then he say, perhaps we should know more about them before we let them live here.
Well, please try not to worry, Eloise. You did the right thing. There's nothing we can do now. The gendarmes will find whoever killed Gerard, believe me. Everything will be all right. Oh, Eloise, have you seen Mrs. Bennett?
She went to town. I hear her say she used up all her film and needs to get more.
All right, thank you. Oh, wait. Where's Mr. Boland?
He went somewhere, too. In Rose Phillips' car. I don't know where.
Oh, okay, that's all. Thank you. Run along now. Try not to worry. Don't worry, I told her, Louise. Do as I say, not as I do. I was worried. Our population had been reduced by 2. And the thought crossed my mind that perhaps more than one psychopath was running loose. But I decided there was more likely just one killer. It was Gerard's job to find out what really happened the night Annabel Lee died. Perhaps he did, and was silenced by the only living person who knew. Just about anyone could have done it. In any case, I was worried. Eloise said that Gerard had been asking questions about me. If the real killer wasn't found, it could have gotten sticky for me. But that was a long shot, wasn't it, Sylvia? A man could go crazy worrying. Anyway, we were running a guest house, not a detective agency. I went to the kitchen to see if Max needed help. Got 2 free hands if you need them.
Don't need them. You've heard about the mass inquisition?
Eloise told me.
Cad, listen. I've been thinking. You haven't been off the island in years. Now, why don't you take some time off? A vacation.
Vacation? What do you think this is, work?
No, I mean it.
No, I don't think a sudden trip would be a very wise thing to do on my part. Besides, until these murders are solved, the police will want us all to stick around. Someone hops a plane and bingo, there's your killer. And I didn't do it. Did you?
Don't be funny. We didn't need this to happen.
You said we had to play it by ear. Maybe we'd get lucky. For 6 years, we've had nothing but four-leaf clovers. Don't worry about it. I'm not.
That's for sure. Gallivanting around with that Bennett woman when you know the place is crawling with...
Just acting natural.
Oh, natural hell. You haven't been seen with a woman since you got here.
Max, I know this sounds foolish, but I believe you're jealous.
Don't be a jerk.
Relax. We'll just stay put. They'll find whoever did it, and then things will be back to normal. People will forget. They always forget. Isn't that what you told me?
Sure they forget. Unless they're reminded by snooping fools who can't let things be. The priors and tattletales. The good liars of this godforsaken world. I didn't need more film. I needed to make a call. That morning, I phoned Carl from Phillipsburg. It was a bad connection. Carl, this is Sylvia. What have you done with the Joseph Johns info I sent you? Nothing, I hope, because there are new developments. You've got to hold it until I get back.
Sylvia, I can't hear you. Where are you, still in San Francisco? What's going on? Have they arrested John?
No, they haven't arrested anybody. Carl, I think I found that Johns is innocent. There's a big town meeting this afternoon. I'm on my way there now, so don't set anything until
Sylvia,
I can...
Love, it's already in. Front cover, too. It was a soft week news-wise, so we blew it up. I've got a copy right here. Looks great. The stack should arrive there tomorrow.
Oh, Carl.
What? What's the matter? Are you all right?
Yes. I'm all right. I'm coming back tomorrow. I'll be on the first plane.
What time? I'll send a car to pick you up.
Don't bother, Carl. It's already too late.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense. But I wouldn't want to die there. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour. Have you ever wondered about the person tucked away in a corner of a toy factory, cutting jigsaw puzzles, taking a finished picture and cutting it up so someone can spend hours, weeks, piecing it back together, feeding the wood or pasteboard into the blade at any desired angle? I wondered about such a person. So too must Sylvia Bennett. The picture she thought she was making is suddenly many new pieces. More red in another corner. The blood of the island newspaper editor. She's no longer sure that the face she thought would be at the center will be there. And as she sits in her New York apartment, reading the letter, the instruction sheet, Sylvia Bennett has reason to believe this puzzle may have more pieces than she first expected. But I wouldn't want to die there. Continues after this word.
That was some meeting. I remember. I made it back from Phillipsburg just in time. We were all crammed in. Everybody seemed to be at the schoolhouse that afternoon.
Everyone from our place. Staff and guests, all the townspeople, visiting Americans, tourists, part-time residents, and Mr. Boland of the press. Even a few curious spectators from Merrick over there. All these people, and yet I could sense the void. Gerard belonged there. Captain Dubois, Inspector Leclerc, and Dr. Fortier sat at the main desk at the head of the class. Leclerc opened the proceedings.
You are all aware of the recent death of Gerard Bonaventure. We regret his passing and that of Madame Annabelle Lee. We are doing all we can to locate the person responsible for their untimely departure. Our belief is we are looking for one person, perhaps present in this room.
They began with me, which made sense. The whole terrible mess started where I began, with my evening walk along the beach. I don't know why I was nervous, but my legs were trembling as I gave my account. Wong and the men from the Riva substantiated my story. After that, the clerk called on Robert Tolliver, and things began to get lively.
Monsieur Tolliver, would you inform us of your whereabouts the day of your wife's demise?
San Juan, most of the day on business. Flew back here for about an hour that afternoon, picked up a check from my wife and flew back.
This business you speak of, the acquisition of Benvenue, was it satisfactorily completed?
Not entirely. It's a very complicated procedure.
Is it not strange that you did not take this check when you first left?
Tanqueray pulled a fast one. He wanted a binder right then and there, a large amount of money. I was afraid he'd call the deal off if I didn't come up with it, so I flew back to get it.
And your wife was alive and well?
I told you she wrote the check. When it comes back with my statement, I'll hand it to you.
We have ascertained from Monsieur Tanqueray that there was such a check. Don't think we doubt that, Monsieur Tolliver.
Look, I can account for every second I was back here. I know what you're trying to pull, and I'm not going to let you get away with it.
Tolliver got red in the face from all his shouting and had to be yanked down into his chair by his friend Bates. The clerk continued with Maria Lisa. She spoke very quietly, giving short answers. Annabel Lee was not a cold person, she said, a kind woman who kept to herself. She had no close friends in Grand Case and never entertained, though visitors dropped by from time to time. Tolliver was smoldering. Did you see him, Sylvia? I could tell it wouldn't be long before he blew. Max was just the one to set him off.
Monsieur Terry, you were in San Juan that day, too.
That's right.
Your pension there has so agreed. Customs have verified both you and Monsieur Tolliver as having boarded the same early flight, though not together. As a neighbor, tell me, how did you feel about Madame Lee?
Well, I felt sorry for her. She seemed such a lonely person. A big star, you know, probably most people were afraid to talk to her.
Lonely, you say? And yet she had a husband.
Well, it's common knowledge they didn't get along.
That's a lie.
There was a terrible bruise on her face one time, and she told me that he gave it to her.
You're lying.
That's what she said.
She ran into a door.
Yeah, the door at the end of your arm.
Mr. Tolliver, please be seated.
This is a farce. Look, we argued. Who's married that doesn't? She wasn't the easiest woman in the world to get along with, but I never hit her, never. I was on my way back to San Juan when it happened, and I could prove it.
Alphonse Tabor, we have been told you spoke to Madame Lee at times. What can you tell us about her?
Oh, she was nice to me, sir. She promised me a week for Carnival. My uncle Nathan did not like me to go there or Oliver either. He said she was a trouble lady.
Hey, what about Uncle Martin? You said you thought she might have been in his boat.
We have no evidence that she was. In addition, Martin Maynard was in the hospital when Gerard Bonaventure was killed.
All right, then. The other one. What's his name there? That space cadet. Just the sort of mentality.
Guy Bousquet was at the gendarmerie at the time of Gerard's death. Furthermore, after interrogation, we do not believe him capable of taking the lady out in a boat and ridding himself of the body without discovery. His mind is that of a child, and he is too public a figure in Grand Case.
But he spied on Annabelle.
This he has admitted. He said he had never seen a lady without clothes. And so he was curious.
And he liked what he saw.
Oh, look at Tolliver.
I love it.
I know.
Yeah. I'm telling you, he did it.
Order! Order! I found it. Order! Order!
We go to the matter of the second murder. Dr. Fortier says Gerard Bonaventure was struck violently on the head before the noon hour yesterday. According to his secretary, Gerard left his office at 11 o'clock. On his way out, he left an advertisement for copying. That advertisement was for you, Monsieur Day. We judge, therefore, that you talked to Gerard Bonaventure perhaps yesterday morning.
Yes, I did.
At what time was this?
Oh, around 10:30.
Around?
10:30. I told him what we wanted the ad to say. He read it back to me and said, thanks. I was rushing off to the market.
And that is where you went after the telephone conversation?
Yes.
Returning when?
Oh, I guess close to 1 o'clock. The lunch crowd was coming in. We were very busy.
Monsieur Cadwallader must have had his hands full serving such a crowd.
No! No, Eloise and Therese were there alone. I'd gone looking for Michel Bousquet to tell him you're taking Guy to Marigot. I went to his farm first, but he wasn't there. Then I ran into Leon Delong, who told me I might find Michel in Pointe Blanche.
Did you find him?
Yes, in the bar under the pier.
At what time?
12:30 maybe. It took me a while to find him.
Michel Bousquet arrived at the gendarmerie at 1:15. Allowing him a half hour to reach Marigot from Pointe Blanche, it would seem you saw Monsieur Bousquet after 12:30, Monsieur Cadwallader.
That's possible.
Why are you concentrating on us? What is this, a play? What are you trying to do?
Monsieur Terry, this is a public inquest. We are attempting to identify a pattern. We are not accusing anyone. Now, please, sit down. Thank you. According to testimony, as you have heard it, Madame Lee left her house sometime in the afternoon, after her guests and maid had gone into Philipsburg. After, her husband says, 4 o'clock. Where did she go?
She goes to
She told Gerard this. I heard her.
Mademoiselle, you will tell us what she saw.
Therese told me Madame Lee was walking on the beach toward Molly Smith Point. She
He was wearing a white bathing suit.
What hour was this?
3 o'clock.
3 o'clock? She was certain.
It had to be 3 o'clock. We'd go home at 3:30.
She's lying. I don't know why, but she's lying.
Wasn't Therese just a little curious to see where Madame Lee was going at 3 o'clock? Didn't she see her meet someone out by the point? Someone with a boat?
No. She told me Madame Lee was walking by herself.
If she left at 3, she was back by 4.
Interesting, is it not? Why she was doing all that coming and going. Especially when she didn't anticipate your return, Monsieur Tulliver. Or did she expect you?
Yes, she expected me. I called from the San Juan airport.
And she must have been very weary from running home from the point. She must have run very fast because no one saw her come back, did they? Anyone?
All right. When I got to the house, she wasn't there. She knew I was coming, but she wasn't around.
You never saw her that afternoon?
No.
How did you get the check, then?
It was there on the desk under a paperweight. No note, nothing, just the check. All signed and ready. So I grabbed it, said to hell with her, and left. And that's the God's truth.
Why, then, did you lie to us? Why say Madame Lee was there when she was not?
Please.
Monsieur Tulliver, we are waiting for your answer.
I have a reason. I had a reason, a good one. The legal matter of the check. If she died before I got it, well, we're not sure it's good.
Surely, Monsieur Tulliver, if it were not, your own funds would be more than sufficient to cover the amount.
Of course, but my money's not so easy to get at. It's tied up. It's all very complicated.
I should say so.
I know what you're thinking. I know how it looks, my being there, like she wouldn't give me the money, so I bopped her with a paperweight or something. But damn it, that's not what happened. I didn't kill her. I didn't lay eyes on her. I can prove I didn't, and you can't prove I did.
Please, Monsieur Tulliver, repeat to us your whereabouts on the morning of the second murder.
You can't pin that on me. No way. Bates and I were at the airport arranging for shipment of my wife's body. I've got a dozen witnesses.
Yes, so you have told us.
That's the truth.
Yes, we know. Nevertheless, it will be interesting to see your wife's check when it is returned. It is always so intriguing to examine the signature. The autograph, as it were, of a famous person.
I don't like your attitude.
Thank you all for coming. We will let you know when we have anything further. This meeting is now adjourned.
I'm afraid I should be leaving. I have things to attend to back home.
Leave when? You don't mean right away.
Yes, right away. Tomorrow.
But Sylvia, you just got here. What's so important?
Things. My apartment. You know, it's not a good idea to leave an apartment empty in New York for too long. If you do, it'll really be empty when
you get
back.
Stay until Saturday. Tomorrow night's the big barbecue.
I think I'd better go.
Don't make up your mind yet. Please, Sylvia.
I don't get it. Why don't they arrest Tulliver? Has he made some kind of deal with the government or what?
They're waiting for something. Don't underestimate them, Max. In the meantime, he can't duck out.
Do you think he killed him?
Hell yes. Who else could it be?
Tad, what do you think?
I'm out of it. I'm not my brother's keeper.
Oh, come on. Take a plunge, Cat. You won't drown. Why don't you ever get your feet wet, Cat?
Perhaps because he's no fool.
Cat, nice, Mr. Cat. The people in this village treat him like a minor deity. If he'd lift a finger, they'd come running to him and tell him everything they know or suspect. But will he lift that finger? No, not noble old Cat. Too damn scared he might have to make a positive move against his fellow man.
You're coming on a bit strong, Max. But you may be right, partly.
What would you do if you knew who the murderer was?
I'll tell you what he'd do. He'd turn his back. That's what. He's a poor damn fool. And he'd go on pretending he didn't know and then try to rehabilitate the killer all by himself. A heart as big as his body. That's what Mr. Cadwallader has got. It makes me sick.
I think I'll go lie down.
No, stay. Max will go instead, won't you, Max? You've been drinking too much, haven't you, Max? And you say things you shouldn't when you're drinking, don't you?
The lady is quite correct. I was just leaving. I bid you both.
I'm sorry, Sylvia, for the way Max acted. It's this whole bloody business.
Why do you take that from him?
He's my best friend, my oldest friend. No, I'll amend that. He's my only friend.
Et tu, Brute?
No, you don't understand, and I could never tell you.
Tell me what, Cat?
Well, I owe Max a great deal. Just take my word for it.
Cat, you really are a coward. You left out the fifth night. But I remember. We never even ate dinner. I guess we were pretty looped. It must have been late. The place was deserted.
To memories.
To old times.
What's the first thing you remember? When you were a child, I mean.
Oh, God, those are old times.
The very first.
Well, I must have been about 3 years old.
That young. You must have been a very bright little girl.
I remember it was Christmas, and I found a kitten in my stocking. Its head was peeping out of the top. I cried. I was so happy.
My first memory is seeing. Yes, my parents bought me glasses and I put them on. And I climbed on a chair to look in the mirror. I didn't know whether to laugh because I could see myself so clearly, or cry because I looked so ugly. I laughed. They did too. What happened to the kitten?
Oh, still makes me sad. It got out in the driveway, and my father ran over it in his car.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So am I. Poor kitty. Never had the chance to grow up.
Those are most unusual bracelets you wear. I noticed them the first day we met, remember?
On the beach.
I don't think I've seen you without them. They're really exquisite. Let me see them.
No, Cat. Please. Go on. Now, you know. They're cover-ups.
You know, my eyes are so bad I couldn't see them. I felt the scars. Why did you do it?
I was tired. Tired of no one caring.
Your husband.
I suppose so.
Wow. Will it do any good to ask you not to try again? Huh? Well, remember, I asked.
We walked up the stairs together. I felt so sorry, so ashamed. I knew what would happen the next day, and I knew I wouldn't be there. When I asked you into my room, Cad, you reacted so strangely. Were you shocked? Or pleased? I couldn't tell. I knew what I was doing, and yet 25 years. It was Joseph Johns I opened my bed to, not you, Cad. We didn't say anything more that night, but I know what you wanted to say. And I know what... Oh, God. Pull yourself together, Sylvia. No more jaded tears. You can only die once. All right, Cad. Throw the switch. Squeeze the trigger. I have no last request. Tell me in your own words how I betrayed you. Just how was it for you when I left? It was the sixth day after
I'd stumbled over the inert figure on the beach by Molly Smith Point. A day accentuated by a profound sense of loss. You, Sylvia, for reasons I would soon discover, left without as much as saying goodbye. If you had, your words fell upon deaf ears. When I woke, you were gone. We on the island lowered Gerard into the ground that afternoon. I was in no mood for a party, but as host, I had my obligations. About the time the sun departed, our guests began arriving. For an hour or so, everything ran smoothly. Alphonse mixed, I served, Max and the girls brought out food, and everyone had a grand time. When people turned their attention to eating, I decided to take a walk. Just to think about things, be alone.
Hey, whatever your name is, hold up! Man, did you ever have me fooled?
What are you talking about?
Read and weep.
Read what? I can't see out here.
It's a new issue of Day. Just look at the cover. He look familiar?
Is that me?
I'll read it for you. It says, found Joseph Johns next door to murder. Looks like your lady friend fooled everyone. Who would have guessed? A dame. Hey, I got a cab waiting and a plane to catch. Thanks a lot for putting me up. Now look, I don't know if you did it, but I wish you all the luck in the world, Johns. You're gonna need it.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense. But I wouldn't want to die there. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour.
You've been listening to the Hollywood Radio Theater's presentation of The Zero Hour. Heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Stanton Forbes, But I Wouldn't Want to Die There, was adapted for radio by Kim Weisskopf. Nehemiah Persoff is Cat. Brock Peters is Leclerc. And Marge Redman is Sylvia. Featured in the cast are Olin Soleil, Alan Reed, Jester Heston, Mady Norman, and William Woodson. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. Jack Myers is executive producer. Rochelle Sherman, associate producer. And Kim Weisskopf, story editor. Music conducted and composed by Stanley D. Hoffman. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. This has been a J.M. Colas Enterprises production. Hugh Douglas speaking. Tune in tomorrow and once again,
rest your eyes and listen here
to The Zero Hour.